contact or you have symptoms, it will be very difficult to test each and every citizen every few days. But all people who are having an influenza-like illness or who are COVID suspects, because of the guidelines laid down by ICMR, should be tested.
I want to, you know, very briefly ask you a follow-up question. When you say high-risk patients should be tested or high-risk asymptomatic contacts should be tested, you obviously mean immunocompromised. Who would you then recommend that they get tested irrespective of being asymptomatic? Who do you define as high-risk?
So those people who are in close contact with the COVID-positive patient, suppose there is another family member who's come in very close contact, and the definition of close contact is there on the website, but it basically means that you've had a very close unprotected contact, which could be for more than 15 or 30 minutes with an individual who was known to be COVID positive, and therefore you have a risk of getting the infection. And like you rightly said, especially those who have comorbidities or who are elderly,
right,
they should monitor themselves closely, and not immediately, but usually on the by the fifth to seventh day, because that is the incubation period that is there,
right,
then they should get themselves tested.
Okay. Dr. Guleria, the Delhi government has decided to close its borders for the rest of the country. They're doing this on a trial basis as of now. AIIMS is an all-India facility. What do you make of this idea of Delhi hospitals only for people of Delhi?
So I think, you know, if you have a sick patient, and we always talk of NCR, which includes cities in the neighboring states also. And also, I think that we should not deny healthcare or health facilities if anyone needs it, even if he's from neighboring areas where that type of facility may not be available. They're all Indian citizens. We are one country. And therefore, it becomes important that we try and support each other as much as possible. And I think in my mind, as far as medicine is concerned, as far as ethics is concerned, these are arbitrary barriers. If I have a sick patient who's coming from even, let's say, Bihar, it's not ethically right to refuse him when he's come all the way and he's very critically ill.
It's very interesting that, you know, you question the ethics of this decision. But there is a larger practical question. NDTV today has uncovered the discrepancy in the COVID app data vis-a-vis the actual availability of beds on the ground. In your assessment, is there a huge shortage of beds, not just here in Delhi, but all over the country? And is that what is prompting governments like the Delhi government to close borders, to restrict who has access to a hospital in a particular geographical location?
So I think what is happening is that we are having spurts of outbreaks in different regions or different parts of the same city. And therefore, like I said, there is a need to really have a coordinated effort. You may have in the same city one hospital which may have very few or no beds, but you may also have another hospital maybe just a few kilometers away that has vacant beds available. So there is a need to develop a coordinated strategy where it's people themselves are also aware of what is the available ICU beds, oxygen beds and other beds in different cities. I mean, if someone has to travel from South Delhi to East Delhi or North Delhi, but a bed can be given there to a sick patient, that should be there, rather than saying that there are no beds in your neighboring hospital and therefore we can't do anything.
Right. There's another, a government versus private healthcare facilities controversy that's brewing. An FIR against Gangaram Hospital for not updating the RT-PCR app data. You know, private labs in Delhi have been issued show cause notices for testing asymptomatic patients, which is now against the Delhi policy. Do you see there is do you look at this like there's a conflict between the government and private healthcare facilities, not just here in Delhi, but perhaps brewing elsewhere as well?
So you see, this is a pandemic. We have to really work together. I think the margin or the borders between a private and a public sector should gradually disappear. And we should say that we should come together in this pandemic, irrespective of whether we are in the government sector, private sector, if it's a government lab or a private lab, have that equity and judicious testing done. There sometimes can be a delay in uploading reports because there are labs which are now testing a huge amount of cases. We ourselves are now testing every day so many cases that the reports sometimes come late in the night, almost after midnight, because of the fact that people are working 24/7 to really give those reports out as early as possible, because we realize that if you start giving reports out late, then it has the person, not only does it increase the anxiety in the individual, but your whole containment strategy, isolation strategy gets delayed because it's all dependent upon the reports. So there is a lot of strain, and I think everyone whether it's in the private sector, the government sector, should come together so that we are able to save lives.
Right. You're a member also of the ICMR task force. The countrywide survey ended this week. What's the general sense that you get, Dr. Guleria? We ask you this question time and time again. Are we in stage three of community transmission?
So I think the data will be out next week. We're also waiting to see what the ICMR data is, because this is a very comprehensive study where zero surveillance, like I mentioned, has been done in a large number of districts in the hotspots and also in districts where there have been very few cases. So that will give us some idea. But regarding community transmission, if you look at it at a national level, there are a large number of states or areas in the country where the cases are very few, and they are, some of them in some places are coming down, and there's really not much evidence to suggest community transmission is happening there. But if you start looking at hotspots, it could be Delhi, it could be Mumbai, it could be Ahmedabad. In these areas, in certain areas, the number of cases is increasing, and there is a very high chance that local spread is occurring out there, and that is why these cases are spiking. The message here is also that these are the areas where we need to focus on containment, isolation, quarantine, all need to be very aggressively followed in these areas if we want to really get the number of cases down.
Right. You know, it's very interesting, because last week in, you know, in one of the health ministry press conferences, an ICMR doctor clarified that not all those dead who test positive are counted as COVID deaths in the country. And they could, and anybody who dies of a comorbidity and is also COVID positive is not counted as a COVID death. There's a fear now of India under-reporting its numbers. What would you like to say about that?
So I think this is something that has always been a debate. Is COVID the cause of death, or was it an association in an individual who, let's say, had myocardial infarction or a heart attack? Now, we also know that COVID can cause myocarditis. It can lead to cardiac changes that may precipitate a heart attack. But it's also possible that this individual had a heart attack and also was an asymptomatic carrier who was having COVID positive.
Right.
It's going to be very difficult to tease out the two things when one looks at these cases. One will have to really critically analyze them, do what we call a verbal autopsy at some point in time to see what could be the cause of death, were there symptoms. But I think to be on the safer side, many of these cases we will have to consider COVID deaths. It's not about the numbers. It's about being able to protect other people. If you have someone who died but was COVID positive, the important issue is also to be able to protect the other healthcare workers or the other family members who have come in contact with him and who need to be isolated and educated as to what they need to do.
But there appears, Dr. Guleria, to be some kind of a confusion in determining COVID morbidity rate. Are we conflicted about who we count as a COVID death?
So there does seem to be some degree of conflict in terms of whether you want to count these patient people or not. In my mind, at this point in time, you could count them and later on do a recalculation or recorrect your data. China did that even months later when they recalculated and actually changed their data, and actually the number of deaths reported were much more. Many countries will do that. So in my mind, currently the issue is to be able to provide better care and protect our citizens and save lives, rather than really sort of arguing on the numbers, because that is something which one can debate later on. Currently, we have a huge number of cases and we need to save lives.
No, I don't mean to argue on the numbers, but definitely, you know, a true representation of numbers, whether it is morbidities or recoveries, or whether it is the number of cases, obviously helps individuals like yourselves and task force, you know, of which you're a part, to better be able to strategize. So that, you know, that's the reason I'm asking this question.
Yes,
but the high rate of infections, you know, amid healthcare workers, there were very disturbing story that we reported this week of 480 staffers at the All India Institute of Medical Sciences testing positive. Now, the government has come out and pretty much put its hands up. The government says that doctors and nurses are responsible for themselves. They should take care of themselves. This is an extremely unfortunate narrative, Dr. Guleria.
So first of all, let me just put this in proper perspective. When we start looking at healthcare workers having the disease, it's important to understand, did they get the infection from the hospital or did they get it from the community?
Yes.
When you have a large number of cases occurring from the community, it's also likely that many of them got it from the community rather than from the hospital. When we started looking at data of these 400 odd patients, we found that more than 95 to 98% of them working in non-COVID areas. As a matter of fact, our staff actually says that the safest place to be currently is actually in the COVID area, because you are protecting yourself so well. We've taken this huge task of making sure that we have a very active hospital infection control team. There are nodal officers in each department, in each area, which make sure that there is training done, even from the security guard to the faculty, so that everyone is trained as far as hospital infection control is concerned. Majority of these patients who've got the infection are people who have come from outside. Remember, we have an actively running hospital, both a COVID and a non-COVID hospital. Large number of staff comes from different areas of the city. And when they travel or when they stay in these areas where the cases are high, there is a likelihood that they get the infection, and we are very concerned that they may therefore pass on the infection to their fellow colleagues in the institute, because many of them are working in, say, record section, or they're working in the administrative section. They don't even see COVID patients, or they don't even come in contact with patients. Yet a large number of them are getting infected. So I think the issue here is that all of us should be very cautious as the lockdown starts getting lifted. We have to be very, very cautious, because as people start moving, as people start interacting, it's very, the chances of meeting someone who is an asymptomatic carrier is very high, especially in cities like Delhi.
Well, absolutely. And, you know, because you've highlighted, you know, this problem of, you know, where people are living and they could actually be picking up the disease from anywhere. You know, when we tweeted about this interview this evening, there were an overwhelming number of questions surrounding the postgraduate exam on the 11th of June. Medical professionals, are they being deprived of the AIIMS PG exam? You know, you have a clause where you don't allow, you know, doctors who've come in contact with COVID patients to appear for this exam. There's a huge row, especially online. A lot of people have tweeted to us about it. Dr. Guleria, would you like to clear the air?
So first of all, let me just say that this exam, we've postponed this twice, and we've consulted the Government of India. Other exams are also just around the corner. Ours is on the 11th. PGI Chandigarh, which holds an All India exam, is on the 14th. A lot of other exams are just around the corner. So it's not that it's only AIIMS which is conducting its exam. A large number of institutes are conducting the exam. The second issue is that we've actually tried to make special precautions. We've even said that those people who are actually being asked to quarantine and coming for the exam, we will make a separate arrangement for them so that they are in a separate isolation facility. The exam is being held in a very unique manner. We've just conducted our own exam here, the exit exam for MD and DM and MCH, the institute, where we've taken extra precautions that there is no touch, there is a scanning done of your face, you just have to show your barcode rather than any signature, and there is a huge social distancing which is maintained.
But not just AIIMS for doctors, Dr. Guleria, isn't it unsafe at this moment as India's cases rise for any institution to be mulling conducting examinations? And in your case, you have a very real problem of dealing with doctors who are either tested positive, doctors who themselves are in quarantine or are exposed to COVID patients on a daily basis.
So that's exactly my point. This is the, if you keep delaying the exam a lot, we still don't know when the peak would happen. It could happen in 2 or 3 months' time. Currently, still early. As you yourself say, every day the number of cases are increasing. We may land up in a situation that students will actually lose a whole session. And that if that happens, then it will be something that we will never be able to forgive ourselves, that we held the exams, we could not hold the exam because the peak happened in August, September, and then we are preparing for the January session, and the students who actually could have gotten and their career could have progressed.
So you're essentially saying it can't be indefinitely held off, but obviously the, you know, the situation or the environment in which you conduct the exam needs to be made conducive. You know, I want to ask you once again about hydroxychloroquine. I know you've cleared the air around it. But after the Lancet study, which has now been withdrawn, there were doubts over the use of hydroxychloroquine. You know, the trials were stopped. They've resumed again. The controversy around the drug never seems to die down.
So the controversy around hydroxychloroquine continues. And as I say, in a lighter vein, it depends whether you're pro-Trump or anti-Trump.
Okay.
But what it basically means is that we still need more data. The data from India, especially as far as prophylaxis is concerned, coming from the ICMR, from our own study, suggests that in healthcare workers who take
Yes.
hydroxychloroquine under close
And
monitoring.
they're continuing to get it as a preventive. There's been another very,
Yes.
you know, interesting medical breakthrough in terms of the antibody test that's been developed by Roche. Do you see that, you know, do you think that this antibody test is promising? It's a crucial breakthrough, like they're calling it?
So the antibody test is already being done. I just mentioned the serosurveillance, which ICMR is doing. A large number of companies have the antibody test. India itself has got an antibody test approved, which was approved by the National Institute of Virology, NIV Pune. And a large number of companies like Cadila, Cipla have started making the kits
Yes.
for the antibody testing. And these kits will be available and they would actually give
But
you an idea of
is the Roche test, as they are claiming, the most accurate antibody test?
No, I don't think that evidence is there. There are all the tests are equally accurate. There are many multinational companies that are coming out with antibody tests, like
Right.
Abbott also is there, Siemens is also there.
Right.
My issue is that antibody test is not a diagnostic test. It's a surveillance test.
Yes.
It is not going to tell you whether you have active infection. It can tell you whether you have infection.
You've had an infection in the past. You know, there's another very interesting development that has happened around a plant-derived drug, AQCH. That's used to cure dengue. That's also showing promise. It's being tried on COVID patients. Would you like to tell our viewers more about that?
So there are a lot of herbal preparation or Ayurvedic preparation which have been looked at, and there are some which people argue are useful as far as bolstering or improving your immunity is concerned. There are very few which actually people have said that are useful as antiviral drugs.
Right.
So there are still a lot of research that is needed, and Ayush itself, in institute, we have what we call CIMR, the Center for Integrated Medicine and Research. Many institutes are trying and starting trials to look at these newer preparation. But I think this is early days. It's going to be difficult straight away to say, based on anecdotal reports, whether these preparations will actually be very useful in the long run.
All right. Dr. Randeep Gulerya, Director at the All India Institute of Medical Sciences, appreciate you for taking out the time of day and answering our questions so patiently.
Thank you. Thank you.
Well, that's all we have time for in the show this evening. Thank you.